2000 Grawemeyer Music Award lecture. This is the 14th award that we've given. Many of you probably know that the awards were started in 1985. Charlie Grawemeyer had the vision that he wanted to help those fields of creative work that really didn't get the recognition that he felt they should. He had a love of music himself, which we're very grateful for. He loved the university, and so we're very indebted to him for having chosen our school as the resource to hold the Grawemeyer Composition Prize. The pleasure that we've had from it in the 15 years since that time has been innumerable. We have not only enjoyed the lectures, we've heard the performances of the music, we've played the music, our students have studied it, and it's been a wonderful resource for them as well. We also have in our music library now one of the largest collections of 20th century music, music of the present day, because each of the scores that was submitted for the competition remains here in our library. So that also has been something that we are extremely proud of. I would like to introduce to you now the chair of the Grawemeyer Committee, Dr. Paul Brink, who will fill you in a little bit more on the award and introduce you to our guest today. Thank you.
Good afternoon. To add just a little bit to Dr. Oliphant's description of the award, one of Charlie Grawemeyer's wishes was to have an award that was significant enough that it would help the winners do what they wanted to do, that is, create. And he was very, very hopeful that we would find young people to really use the award. Our first two winners, Vito Ludoslavski and Georg Pigeti, actually were well-established composers when they won. But to Charlie's delight, they took the money and established trust funds that were used to help young composers go abroad to study, which they felt was very important. Our fourth winner, Chenery Young, was 40 years old when he won the award. And this was something that he could use, and I remember his comment at the award dinner when he said that now he wouldn't have to teach summer school anymore. So it did mean something to him. And this time, we're very, very fortunate, and I think we have finally succeeded in doing what Charlie really wanted to do, and that is find a young, promising composer that is really just getting started, that even though our winner is a pianist and a conductor, this award will make it possible for him to do a little bit less of that, a little bit less traveling, and really concentrate on the composition. So we are very, very proud to welcome from London, England, our award winner this year, Thomas Adès, for the work Asyla.
Elucidate and try to just describe what was happening. So Well, there is a CD player there, and I have the beat. I don't really want to play the bits of it and say, no, this is what's happening next, or that, because it's I see it as an experience that you have to have in a way for yourself. Perhaps if I have a lecture here which I'm going to read, but perhaps if when I get to the end of it there's time, I shall simply play the piece if you haven't heard it already. So I talked about getting away from words, but the piece does of course contain a word, the title, Asyla, a title which has already found resonance in this lecture, this talk, with the word escape. I talk about escaping from words into music. But Asyla is of course a somewhat formal plural of the word asylum, a place of safety of one sort or another. And to my mind, situates the work somewhere within that realm where artistic activity is believed to allow access to an elsewhere ourselves existing within the rest of the time. Day-to-day life now saturates us with information. We are more accessible as individuals to personal and social outside influences than our forebears ever were. One might say that it's a matter of choice. We can, with effort, affect the degree to which these external influences permeate our lives, but it takes more than merely flicking a switch. With the pressure to be in touch with the world, it seems more and more like taking a stand, whereas it is a matter of personal decision how much in touch we are. I don't have a television, nor does a newspaper ever come into my hand, which is essential to me to be able to work. Yet I have had reactions when I told people this that suggest that they're offended in some way. Perhaps this is because there's a certain almost evangelical zeal surrounding communications technology and communication in general. The internet itself is a banal tool indeed, given the burning devotion it inspires and the international panacea it is promoted to be by our leaders. Communication is becoming compulsory. It has never been easier to communicate. But if art is about communication, as we so often hear it should be, it is hardly a competitive medium in the modern world. Besides, in an age apparently committed to total permeability of information, the space between individuals dwindles and disappears. The distinctions between people, between nations, become... So there is a paradox here. What's the point of communication when consciousnesses are virtually identical? Because of blanket exposure to the same information, the same imagery as each other. Do we need so much communication when it has left us so little to say? The problem here, it seems to me, lies in the nature of communication. One can communicate a fact, a piece of news. One can also, of course, communicate a disease. But there may be people among us who would say that the purpose of art is to communicate emotion. Well, let us say for the sake of argument that this is true. And while I'm talking about this, please bear in mind, I am actually talking about my piece, but in an oblique way. Say I am angry, and I wish to communicate that anger to you. If I say to you, I am angry, have I communicated the anger? No. If I make angry music, will my anger be transferred to you through the ears? I bang a drum, angrily. My guitar releases angry sounds. I have expressed my anger, but your response may be one of enjoyment, of mild pleasure, of complete indifference. You may feel the opposite of anger, or a different kind of anger from me, maybe annoyed with me for banging the drum. You may not even notice me at all. There is no way for me to predict what a listener's emotions are going to be. And also, I find it a little patronizing on my part to assume that I could know exactly how to arouse in the audience this emotion or that according to what I want them to feel at any given time. But in an environment, perhaps, let's say a commercial environment, wherein art is required to move us when, where, and precisely how we expect to be moved, and if it doesn't perform, it has failed, in such a climate as that, we may get the art that we deserve and earn the low esteem of a later age. And yet there is, of course there is, a level of feeling which only art can access, perhaps at the most primal animal level, but through music. It's an experience of transcendence, which we all, I'm sure, would have certain works, certain music in mind associated with. And it's beyond words. And it's not communication that's taking place at these moments. It's at a level beyond that which we can put in a communicable order. I believe beyond whatever it is that's called personality. Indeed, an artist's work goes far beyond an artist's person, whoever he or she might be. Just as music moves the listener at a level beyond their personality, that music comes about through Pursuit's work, beyond the personality of the composer. So, in an interview that an artist might give, the moment he or she leaves off talking about thickness of paintbrush, hardness of pencil, or word processors versus longhand, that's the moment when he stops talking about that, that the interview loses its value for me. Personal habits, daily rhythm of work, when they stop and have a cup of coffee, or answer the telephone, social behaviour, sense of humour, all bear no relationship, I think, at all, certainly a necessary relationship with the work that they do, but with another social person myself. I've always enjoyed the so-called meet the composer schemes, but they are rather misnamed, because it's impossible to meet the composer in that sense. As a person with flesh and blood, it's not the same thing that you see in front of you and that produces the work, which can be disconcerting for me as well. Something recently happened, I'm going to tell you. A close friend, someone I've known for years, is a singer who supported me very much when I was really just starting. And we were recently rehearsing something, a piece I've written for her to sing. A piece we've performed many times on many occasions. Something of a dark text and a dark setting. And in the middle of the rehearsal, she stopped and looked at me and she said, "You know, Tom, you're so nice, and this is so horrible." But the thing is, I was actually pleased when she said, because the reason I was pleased was that you might be a person who finds it impossible to say certain things because your personality won't quite allow you to say them. Maybe because you have a residual desire to be liked or to be agreeable, and most of us do, I'm sure. And yet, those are things that can find expression in your work. They may not be nasty things, they're just difficult to say. We can't really be in favour, I can't be in favour of an art that aims only to please. And a critical word here is not the word please, but the word aim. I wouldn't trust work that has for its goal, apparently, nothing but the wish to be tolerated until it stops. We have to allow more ambition to our artists. So what about appeals? For some reason, this is most commonly said to composers, actually, that they should aim to reach a wider audience. It's very easy to say, but what does it mean? So I think it means one of two things, either more people thousands rather than hundreds of people, certain numbers, or perhaps people from a wider variety of social backgrounds. These are two completely different issues. If it's a matter of numbers alone, what is being called for, I think, is a music that captivates a larger crowd all at the same time, that can communicate itself through the mass media, on TV, through a tiny little car radio that can only, you know, get across the crudest things, or even an immense sound system. Well, it doesn't really work like this. I don't believe that's the way towards a wider audience, for one reason, which I'll try to explain. So being in a huge crowd of people, say at a rock concert, all yelling the words along with a tiny, inaudible figure half a mile away, it may be an intense and primeval thrill, and certainly an emotional experience of one sort. Yet belonging to such a crowd and yelling along is a way, I think, of celebrating the reinforcement by the singer, by the words of the song, of something one wants to find inside one's own personality. So you're celebrating in a way what you think is yourself. We're yelling in recognition of an image which you might hope is your image. It's a funny thought in a sense, 10,000 people all singing the same words and thinking, this is me. Well, what interests me here, and what I think informs this piece that I've written, Asyla, particularly in one movement of the piece, which is, if you like, set in such an environment, is what happens to those feelings, those beliefs of needing to belong to many, when that individual is back home, alone. Where is the music for that person? I think, surely or arguably, the greatest piece of music about this, about the mass experience, is the so-called Ode to Joy of Beethoven. But I think that work speaks so deeply, not because it's designed to rouse a crowd, but because it directs itself far above the crowd, about everybody and everything. And I don't see really how Beethoven could have tailored his work towards seizing a huge crowd on today's scale. A crowd not just in the room with him, but miles and miles away, maybe thousands of miles away, maybe one day millions of miles away. And I mean all the way, not just the tune. How could he have done that when there is no longer one sort of music that everybody likes? Try to think of one, there isn't one. And here's the other meaning of wider audience that I mentioned earlier. The idea of wiping the social boundaries, maybe alleged, to which music's accessible. And now that everyone, in theory, anyone, has a potential to experience art, where does the artist turn? What music is it that we all share? Well, I believe there is something which is universal and infinitely valuable. We all have it, every single person. It's what I would call our aloneness. And I'm not talking about a solitude, being on one's own, loneliness. It's nothing to do with that really at all. But aloneness, and it's a thing that we never discuss, because it's at once too simple and too complex. Sometimes we don't know that it's there at all, but it is always there, like an underground river, every day. It may be just an inner dialogue or monologue, sometimes not much more than a rhythm, sometimes an intricate counterpoint of conscious and unconscious manners. But everybody has this, and it just can't be described. Most of the time, it's quite disorganized. But it's never predictable. You never know what will be in your head when you wake up on going to sleep. And this, for me, is where music belongs. it's where I imagine my music is destined to go. I hope it is when people hear it. It's a self that we cannot describe, and we cannot communicate. And the best of all, I think, is that we cannot control it. Now, it's now about 20 past, and I think what I might do, I suspect some of you may not have heard this piece, I'd like to play just the last two movements. And the reason I'm going to do that is that I've talked about the experience of being in a crowd at a rock concert. This isn't exactly a rock concert, but it's more of a rave scene. But it's the third movement. And I think that now you've heard me going on about my concerns, it may inform a little bit the way that you hear this music. And I think also when it's finished, there'll be time if you want to put me on the rack and ask any questions.
I like to listen quite loud.
just because I looked at the time and I knew that it would be easier to end with the end. Also because I think I wanted to include the third movement today because I've been talking in that way about the popular music and I see, I think I tell you also the third movement, I think very much there's a, it's about crowds, whether or not there's actually one there or not, but it's about the issue of how crowds behave. And I've noticed that, you know, I wanted to write a piece there that had the same relationship to techno music that, this is sticking my neck on the line, but in some way that perhaps the classical minuet had to the peasant form of the dance originally, I mean that kind of relationship. And but I had a lot of trouble starting because I hadn't really listened to this sort of music in a listening to it way rather than just hanging around me. And I had problems, and I listened to some, I borrowed some from a friend of mine, listened to it quietly. And I found that things were being repeated really 8, 16, 32, 64 times. It was built on an enormous scale, like almost a Brookmerian scale actually, and very similar technique in places. And that was a help because I could then see how powerful this music is with a crowd, because if you were to take a beat out here or there, half a beat, I think they would all fall over. That's how powerful it is, and that movement I think is but you see the first two movements, it's a little harder to find exact imagery that was in them, but I think if I remember rightly, the second movement, which is a slave movement, didn't have one stage have a title, Vatican. But it was too specific, you know, it means too many things, which are too specific, and there's nothing Roman Catholic about the music, it wasn't that, it was more the sense the word gave of a big religious space in both senses. And it was that sense of cathedrals in which, you know, when the city is under threat, people always used to flock to the cathedral, whether it was from natural or war or a disaster. They would go to the cathedral and think they're safe here. And so that was the second movement. And the third movement is another kind of going to a big crowded dark space with all of us making it and feeling safe. So that was a simple image. But I would like to really have just played you the whole piece and then have questions. doesn't quite accord with the idea of a lecture. I see what you mean, although I don't feel it as a contradiction. I've written up there quite a lot of songs, and I think what I'm saying is that words also can be not just words. You know, one can say words, and actually there's something else underneath it, and it's all just a metaphor for something else. And when I accept the words in the opera, I think I wanted to give a feeling with the music that there was more to the words than just the words. I like opera which works in that way. It's very multi-layered, elusive, in which there's a sort of third thing that results when you put the words to the music, if you do it as best you can. And there's a word music, and there's a third thing comes, and I couldn't tell you what it's called. And also, I suppose when I talk in that way about music, my music is very, there are no concrete ideas, but it's not exactly true in the sense that it's not abstract music, as you might think of abstract music being. But I think all music is actually a metaphor subject, and then there's the second subject, and da 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 da. We could say there's Ferdinand and Miranda and the island and Caliban, and it's but there's no qualitative difference between talking in those ways. You see, so when I set words in an opera, to get back to your question, I think it's also, yeah, that's the other thing. It was in the opera that you heard it. It's in theory very, very concrete. It's London in the 20s and the 30s and the 50s and the 80s. It's a very familiar setting. For me, it's a familiar setting. That book, the 80s and the 90s. And yet, I think I wanted to give a sense that it wasn't that at all. There was always something else behind it. And it's a great gift of opera in the last century, the 20th century, that I particularly love those ones which are set in very kind of real places, and yet something totally beyond that is presented, is there on the stage. And, you know, Janáček does this a lot. He does it particularly in the Macropolis case, where you have 1920s settings, telephone, car, people coming waving the papers, it's the electric bells, people fall asleep, the main heroine, she snores, and, you know, it's all, and yet she's 375 years old. So the supernatural is there, and Lulu as well, so there has a similar quality. So it's very much like that. But what I would find difficult is saying, this movement is kind of calling the piece sort of elegy for da 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 or something very concrete. I would find that very hard, too explicit and too limiting, because if the thing is a good enough elegy, it can be for anything.
Do you have a vocabulary of intervals, harmonic structure, rhythmic structure that for you means certain feelings or concepts, and you use them as words or sentences, I'm using that word generically, to convey? Or is every time you approach music an experiment in trying to create a feeling?
The latter, really. Every piece is different in that respect. But within one piece or another, I think that as I'm working, very quickly, certain sorts of tension begin to attach themselves to one, perhaps harmony or note or area, and other sorts to another one, and they get very, very, very strongly opposed. And from that, the music actually can grow from that a lot of the time, from a big, a strong opposition between images. I think that you're never conscious that this or that chord represents this or that emotional state or whatever it is, but these things begin to attach themselves during the course of working, yes. And it can be quite visual things.
On Thursday, we watched a film about you, and you said in your position as a music director for the opera, you kind of plan shows that you would yourself like to hear. I was wondering what kind of composer, what kind of music you listen to when you're not composing. Kind of, who are your favorite composers?
I tend to have obsessions that go from one year to another, and I sort of put them back on to one side. Beethoven is not in that category. He's a constant obsession, and it's very unlikely to go away. But that's probably because there's so much new. It's so many. There are actually very few composers that I really find nothing too interesting. I won't say who they are. I think it's very Yes, I could. I think living twice would make a good ballet. In fact, there are plans to do that. And it's really just down to the choreographer, actually. I've had a piece danced, I thought, rather dully. But then I had another piece which was set brilliantly by a New York choreographer with New York City Ballet stars, and it was really